Chris, welcome to our RCF Online Sunday gathering on Sunday, May the 9th. Today, continuing with our Unquenchable series through the book of Acts, this week, Ali is going to pick up on Acts chapter 18, 1 to 17. Lots packed into a few verses. We're going to meet some new people who are going to have a big impact upon the still fledgling church. And we're also going to see a change in Paul's ministry direction. So hang on tight. It's going to be an exciting ride this morning. So before we start, we're going to pray and we're going to ask the Holy Spirit to help us and guide us this morning as we listen to his word and as we encourage one another. So Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would help us this morning by your Holy Spirit. Teach us, enlighten our hearts, give us a real understanding of your heart towards this world that we live in. Strengthen us, encourage us, and cause us to walk in all that you have for us. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Scroll. sing hallelujah. Come we sing hallelujah. Come we sing hallelujah. The lion has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Come we sing hallelujah. The lion has
Hi everyone, I'm doing a prayer this morning and I would like to take you all on a bit of a reflection really on the love of God. I've got a scripture verse from Romans that I'd like to read with you, and then I've taken a little bit of Romans and put it in my own words just to try and bring it closer maybe to our reality. So I'll start with the scripture verse. It's Romans 8 verse 16 and 17, and it's from the Message Bible, and it says this: God's spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who he is and we know who we are, father and children, and we know we are going to get what's coming to us. An unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. And I feel that that sort of speaks to me about God being my father and being with me through whatever happens in my life. I'm sure it's much the same for you, but my life's not always easy. Sometimes it's great, sometimes it's painful, sometimes it's really hard. Sometimes I'm busy, sometimes I'm distracted, but he loves me and he's with me. And this morning I'd love to reflect on that with you. And this is a piece in Romans about how nothing can separate us from the love of God. And I've put it a little bit in my own words. I'd like to read it with you. I'd love you to, if you can, to quieten yourself a little bit and just listen to it as if it's being said to you, you know, by God maybe. So here we go. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Not trouble. Not hard times, not other people's angry words spoken to us, not our busyness or the next phone call or WhatsApp or our distracted state, not our fears, not our worries about the ones we love, nothing thinkable or unthinkable today or tomorrow can separate us from the love of God, our Father. And Yeah, I just love to think with you about that. So, Father, I pray that today, as we're listening, that you will reveal to us your love, how constant you are, that you are with us, and that your love doesn't depend on where we are at, whether we're in a good place or in a bad place, whether we're busy or maybe even too busy to be with you, or too distracted in our minds to listen to you. And Father, I pray that that you will come into our distractedness, into our busyness, into our good times and into our hard times. And I pray that that your love will come through to us, to love us and to come through us to others just in our daily existence. Yeah, thank you, God, for your love for us. Amen.
Hello, and welcome back to Acts After All Sorts last week. I have been looking forward to this one. When Kurt and I were discussing the rota, I specifically asked for this week in Corinth, as I've got great memories of visiting the place when I was about 13. But let me just start by recapping how we got here and setting the scene, and hopefully painting a vivid picture for you of what first century Corinth was really like. We'll just begin with a very quick recap video of this missionary journey so far. Because when you learn about anything, repetition is key, and it's key to laying down retrievable memory. So I hope you are learning something in this series. You know, let us know if you are. Feedback would be great. Tell me something you've learned that you didn't know before. Here's the video.
And so we come to Paul's second missionary journey. At the end of January, Gez told us all about Paul and Barnabas making a trip to Jerusalem to sort out the circumcision problem. And then Paul and Barnabas had one almighty humdinger of a row and parted ways. So Paul picks Silas to travel with him on his second journey, and off they go. This time by land, back through many of the names of towns that you'll recognise from the first journey, revisiting and encouraging friends and new believers. They think about heading north, but the Holy Spirit stops them, and instead, as the result of a dream where a man from Macedonia begs them to come, they head to the leading city of Macedonia, Philippi. It was in Philippi that Paul and Silas, and now Timothy and Luke as well, met Lydia and started a gathering at her house. Here in Philippi, Paul and Silas were also thrown into prison, but as they were singing and praying, there was a violent earthquake and the doors fly open. In that encounter, the jailer is about to commit suicide when Paul shouts, "We're all here!" And the jailer's life is saved twice over, and his whole family get baptised. On to Thessalonica, where they manage to start a church in 3 weeks, but again get run out of town by an angry mob. 50 miles further south, they arrive at Berea, and they receive a warm welcome by the studious and eager Bereans. But the mob from Thessalonica finds out where they are and sets out to pursue them to Berea. At this point, Paul is separated from some of his companions. Silas and Timothy stay in Berea, but Paul catches a boat and sails down the coastline to Athens. Last time, Andy told us all about Paul's time in Athens, with all the deep thinkers and philosophers of the day. But now, Paul travels to Corinth, which might as well have been a world away in terms of its inhabitants and culture. This ancient double-port city would be where Paul spends the next 18 months. And it's interesting to me that Paul chooses to stay here, not with the welcoming and enthusiastic Bereans or the intellectual Athenians, but instead with the drunken and debauched sailors, the multicultural, multi-ethnic traders, entertainers, tavern owners and prostitutes. I can't wait to tell you more about this city of pleasures in today's talk.
There is so much here that I could get into, but I'm going to spend part one just getting you to imagine what this city was like before I explain the narrative in part two. Because this is, after all, where Paul spent a year and a half. And I want you to understand the context into which he writes his letter to the Corinthians after he leaves, because it will really make those letters come alive for you. So Corinth, another 50-mile walk on from Athens, and yet, as I mentioned in the video, it could have been another world. I want you to imagine that it was like leaving the academic cloisters of Oxford and going to the Strip in Las Vegas, from Oxford to Sin City. This is the kind of difference that I am talking about. And as such, this part, part one, might come with more of a maybe, I don't know, PG-13, 15 rating, if you feel that your younger children might want to do something else at this point. So this ancient port city, in fact, it's a double port city, was the greatest port in ancient Greece. It lay on a narrow 3-mile isthmus. And that's a really tricky word to say, and I'm going to have to say it a few times, between two large sub-bodies of the Mediterranean Sea. So Corinth had a western seaport and an eastern seaport, and ships would dock at one side, the cargo would be unloaded and then transported the 3 miles across and reloaded onto a waiting ship on the other side. And all of this to avoid sailing all the way around Greece, and thereby saving captains and merchants loads of money, loads of time, and also risk. In fact, there was enough revenue made from transporting the contents of the goods of the ships down the causeway across the isthmus that the city's citizens didn't have to pay any taxes. Nowadays, they have built a canal across the 3 miles, which I was lucky enough to see when I was young, and it is truly amazing. Now, I want you to think about ports. Ports are full of sailors, naturally, and sailors have got a bit of a reputation for being foul-mouthed, hard-drinking, and ready to blow off steam after being stuck on a boat for weeks at a time. Sailors have got often fewer family ties or stability, and they live quite transitory lives. Also, because of the transfer of goods in the town, it was also the primary commercial hub of the whole area. Lots of shops, lots of goods, lots of imports. The transient population on top of the regular population meant that you had Greek, Roman, what they would have called Oriental people in Corinth. And the focus on pleasure after voyages, on spending money on goods, and the focus on entertainment made Corinth a hotbed for several things. They had a theatre that housed 20,000 people. Can you even imagine that? The city was a centre for prostitution and therefore venereal diseases. It had 12 pagan temples that ritualised prostitution into worship. The Temple of Aphrodite alone had 1,000 priestesses who were actually temple prostitutes, and worship involved sexual encounters with these priestesses. So much so that there was a Greek term that came into usage, Corinthiasmai, which meant to act like a Corinthian, but it was used in conversation to mean to practice fornication. The city was jammed full of pubs and taverns. Did you know that archaeologists have found kind of wine coolers, little wells, inbuilt wells into the floors of almost every shop in the city? It was a cultish city full of shrines and fountains because they also venerated water and caves, and they developed rituals around bathing and drinking and food offerings. And here is a list. Andy mentioned some of them last week, didn't he? Here's a list of some of the gods and goddesses that they worshipped. I want to pick out just two to mention. Aphrodite, or Venus, the Roman name, was the city's protector deity. And her temple sat right on the top of the hill above Corinth, looking down over the city. And really, she set the whole tone for the city. And if you think of Venus as the goddess of love, well, it was much less about love and much more about sex. It was a totally hedonistic mindset. And then the second god is Asclepios. Now, he was Apollo's son. And the reason I mention him has to do with a story of my time in Corinth. Now, Asclepios was the male god of healing. There was a sanctuary of Asclepios in the city where people could go and make shrine offerings. And they would take the waters and they would ask for healing. And when I visited Corinth in 1987, my family and I were shown around the Archaeological Museum of Ancient Corinth, where our guide, who was a lovely Christian Greek brother, told us about 900 or so votives that had been excavated from the Asclepion. Votives were clay models of body parts that local Corinthian potters would be commissioned to make. And then the person suffering would take the model of their ailment to the sanctuary to request healing from the gods. Now, the potters in Corinth were already famous for their black figure pottery that has become synonymous with ancient Greece. So there was plenty of work if you were a potter in Corinth. Now, some of you can maybe see where this story was heading. So I'm in this museum with my family, and it was astonishing walking into a room where hanging all over the walls were clay votives of arms and legs and hands and eyes and feet. It was really impressive. What I wasn't prepared for was when I trotted along behind my dad and our guide took us into a back room. I'm not even sure if we were supposed to be there or not. I don't know. But I kid you not, the entire walls were covered in male and female genitalia. Now, if you're of a sensitive disposition, you might want to look away now. Here were the only images that I could find online depicting what I saw and what I can remember, because you're not allowed to take pictures of them. So there's very few images online. These are not in the mainstream. I could only find these in academic papers. And back as an impressionable teenage girl, my dad only had to give me one cheeky glance and with a wink in his eye, and that was it. We were off, trying desperately not to laugh at the wall, this entire wall of very personalised penises, as our guide carried on talking. Now, what hits me now probably about this is, I guess, what I missed at the time he was probably saying, because I was too busy trying not to giggle, which of course was that there are so many of these votives of male and female parts found in this city because the city was riddled with sexual diseases. You know, votives of body parts have been found recovered in many other large Roman cities across the Roman world, but only in Corinth have so many penises been excavated. And there's a sentence I thought I'd never say on a Sunday morning. So when Paul writes to those in Corinth, he had to define Christian behaviour in the middle of a city of hedonism. He had to describe what a different Christian lifestyle should look like. How do they modify their behaviour to one another and to those around them? And, you know, he really needed to be uncompromising about that, as well as loving. Scholars think that Paul wrote at least four letters to the Corinthians, and that probably our 1 and 2 Corinthians are actually letters 2 and 4. It's interesting, isn't it? But, you know, you think about all of this casual sex, prostitution, venereal disease, life driven by entertainment but not commitment, lust and not love, and you then go and read 1 Corinthians 13, and you look at how Paul redefines love instead of this hedonistic, hypersexualized image of love, and it makes what he says all the more poignant. I'll just share one more point of interest I learned about in Corinth before we examine today's scripture. Another side to entertainment in Corinth was the games. You know, you all know about the Olympic Games that started in Olympia. But Corinth held the Isthmus Games. I've got to say that word again. The Isthmus Games, which were held in the year before and the year after the Olympics in the 4-year cycle. And so there was a huge stadium built in Corinth for races, foot races and chariot races. And one thing that our guide told us about was all about the wreaths that were awarded to the winners. Actually, in the Greek history, they started off actually as wild celery leaf wreaths, but they became the more recognisable bay laurel leaf wreaths. Struggling with my words this morning. Bay laurel leaf wreaths that we associate with the Greeks and Romans. They're even worn still today by graduates in places like Italy. And victors were awarded these laurel leaves, and it's from that that we derive our words like Nobel laureate and poet laureate. But as you can imagine, after winning a race and being awarded one of these wreaths, they didn't last very long. Shortly afterwards, they would wilt and fall apart. And that's why when Paul writes to the believers in Corinth, in his letter, he talks about the games and he draws out a metaphor. In 1 Corinthians 9:25, he says, "Everyone who competes in the games trains with strict discipline. They do it for a crown that is perishable." He's talking about those wilting laurel leaf crowns. "But we do it for a crown that is imperishable." And that Stephanos, that's the word, the Greek word, the Stephanos for a circlet laurel crown, is the same crown that is described in Revelation 6:2, where John describes seeing a conqueror on a white horse wearing a crown. And it's not the diadem, the kind of royal metal crown that he describes. No, the crown that he mentions is the laurel wreath crown, the Stephanos, for victory. And do you know where else they're worn? They're also worn at weddings to symbolise nuptial joy. So that picture in Revelation is of the bridegroom victor. And lastly, do you know where else the word Stephanos is used? It is used to describe that crown of thorns that Jesus wore on the cross. The victor over death. Oh, I could go on. Thank you for indulging me. I promise that's the end of part one. I hope it's not been too off point. I'll see you again in part two.
Lord, and most worthy of praise, the city of our God, the holy place, the joy of the whole earth. Great is the Lord in whom we have the victory. Us against the enemy. We bow down on our knees. And Lord, we want to lift your name on high. And Lord, we want to thank you for the works you've done in our lives. Trust in your unfailing love, for you alone are God eternal, throughout earth and heaven above.
So let's dive in to the text today. Paul has left the academic Athenians and he's arrived in Sin City to live amongst the carnal Corinthians for 18 months. And it sounds like the first friends that he made were a Jew called Aquila and his impressive wife called Priscilla. They are tent makers, like he is. So I imagine that's how they met, probably over a conversation, either at the market stall, or he sought them out to pick up some work. I mean, presumably that's how they start a conversation. And so he gets an invite to stay and to work with them. And I'm not going to say much more about them because their story starts to unfold over the coming weeks. Every Sabbath, he does his usual thing. You all know by now, he goes and finds the synagogue. He goes to the local synagogue and begins talking. But as usual, it's not long before some of the Jews take offence at something he's got to say. In the meantime, he's reunited with Silas and Timothy, who have left Berea and they've made their way to Corinth too. And with their arrival and presumably their ability to bring a little bit more income, it frees Paul up to spend all of his time talking. And the Jews that he has annoyed start to kick up a fuss. And it says, the word it uses is that they become abusive. So Paul literally, but also very symbolically, walks out of the synagogue and goes right next door to the house of Titius Justus. Definitely a Gentile, possibly even a Roman citizen. And verse 6 uses this very funny phrase. It says, Paul shook out his clothes in protest on the way. And he also says to them, your blood be on your own heads. I'm clear of my responsibility. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles. Now, Jews would shake off pagan dust when they travelled from a Gentile territory back into the Holy Land. But with his final line, kind of Paul reverses the usual Jewish practice of, you know, cleaning their feet and shaking off the dust before they went from Gentile to Jewish territory. No, Paul is moving, if you like, from Jewish territory in the synagogue to Gentile territory, the house next door of Titius Justus, and he's shaking off the dust before doing so. Now, the demonstration of which would not have been lost on his audience. I mean, this is a proper kick in the teeth for them. I can't help thinking that Titius Justus, who's got a suspiciously Roman sounding name, must have been quite an extraordinary character to take somebody into his home who has seriously annoyed a group of people who frequent next door every week. I mean, every Saturday, they're next door. Now, we're not sure, but Paul may have stayed with Titius Justus for the whole 18 months he was in Corinth, right next door to the synagogue and preaching to the Gentiles. I mean, talk about a powder keg environment. It's not all of the Jewish people that reject Paul. I mean, interestingly, it says the synagogue ruler, a man named Crispus, and his whole family become believers and Paul baptizes them. Now, he would have been the man who allowed Paul to come and speak at the lectern of the synagogue, but he may well have lost his job for it, as we'll see in a minute. Just as an aside, if you look back, Jairus, remember Jairus's daughter who was healed? Jairus was a synagogue ruler as well, it tells us in Mark. So Gentile Christians begin to outnumber Jewish converts in Corinth. And then one night, Paul has another dream and God speaks to him in this dream and he gives him some real encouragement. He tells him four key things. He says, don't be afraid, you know, keep on speaking, don't give up. I am with you. No one is going to attack or harm you. And I have many people in this city. And that dream, I think, must have kept him going through many a hard day or week even. Promises from God. And I kind of read it that that God has already, he's got people who he's decided are his, people that he uses for his purposes, those that are going to receive the gospel from Paul and join the kingdom, and those who've already decided, they're all his people. And as we move on to verse 12, it mentions a Roman proconsul. Now, do you remember we met another proconsul on Cyprus in the first missionary journey? Well, this one was called Gallio. He was a friend of the Emperor Claudius. And we've actually got the advantage of history to tell us that 15 years later, after this trial with Paul, Gallio actually is executed by the kind of maniac Emperor Nero in 65 AD. But at this point, the Jews, who are annoyed with Paul, they bring him to the magistrate's court, or the judgment seat, which was called the Bema. Now, you can still visit the Bema today in Corinth. The Bema was at one end of the town centre kind of courtyard. It was where public offences were heard, judged and penalised. It's also where they lined up the athletes who were rewarded. It's kind of a platform of stone that is raised, and Paul is dragged before this magistrate, Bema judgment seat, and he's ready to make his defence. But Gallio dismisses the case. He doesn't want to know. He's not bothered. To Gallio, it's only Roman law and breaking the law that matters. He's not interested in little aspects of Jewish law. He says, if you Jews were to come and make a complaint about some misdemeanor or serious crime, it would be reasonable for me to listen to you. But since it involves questions about words and names and your own law, well, settle the matter yourselves. I will not be a judge of such things. Do you hear that? Words and names. I think clearly the complaint is all about Paul again declaring the name of Jesus. There's another king. His name is Jesus. And Gallio just has them ejected, moved on from the Bema seat. And then it says, a mob turned on the synagogue leader, who by now is no longer Crispus. It's a man named Sosthenes. And they beat him to a pulp in front of the court. And it says, Gallio showed no concern whatsoever. The question that I had is, well, who is this mob made up of? Is it Gentile Greeks? Or is it those unbelieving Jews? And the answer is not very forthcoming, despite me doing a lot of reading on the matter. Opinion is very divided. There are those who are sure that the rabble are Greek and they're just picking on the synagogue leader after he gets his case thrown out. But there's also another compelling argument that comes that if you imagine that these are Sosthenes' own Jewish congregants, people that he's in synagogue with, who think that he's not done a good enough job presenting the case for Paul's guilt, possibly because he's having his own doubts about the validity of it. The reason for thinking this is that if you turn to 1 Corinthians 1, there is a chance that somehow it's the same Sosthenes who's either travelled then with Paul on to Ephesus and become an amanuensis, you know, someone who writes down what Paul has to say. Now, wouldn't that be a story? You know, synagogue ruler Crispus becomes a Christian and loses his job. So then sometime later, Sosthenes becomes the synagogue ruler in his place and boom, becomes a Christian as well and sets off with Paul to Ephesus. Now, it's only conjecture. And Sosthenes was a fairly common name, apparently. So here we're only guessing. But it's just interesting to me. I was watching a webinar recently with a New Testament scholar who specialises in Luke and Acts. And he said that when you write things down on a scroll that needs copying to be distributed, everything you write matters. Everything's intentional. It's not like you've got a 1 terabyte hard drive, you know. Everything you write down on that scroll, word by word, matters. So the inclusion of what happened to Sosthenes is no accident. And the inclusion of the name at the start of 1 Corinthians is also no accident. It makes me so wish that we could read those missing letters to Corinth, especially the first one, because that may well have contained more clues. We just don't know for sure. Anyway, that's where my allotted part of the story ends, and it's the end of the information in Acts about what happened to Paul in Corinth. And next time he will be leaving Corinth and heading to Ephesus across the sea to Syria, and he's going to take Priscilla and Aquila with him. However, you're going to have to wait, it's actually more than a month, you've got to wait now till I think it's the 13th of June to conclude that second missionary journey and start the third. Because in between we've got Ascension Sunday, Pentecost, Vision Sunday and an All Sorts before that. So try and keep everything filed away that you've learnt safely in your memory until then. Bless you. Have a great day.
Thank you for being with us today. If anything that's been said has been of encouragement to you, please drop us a line. We would love to hear from you. You can find our details at www.rcfnorthwales.com, or you can email me directly at kurt-rcf@gmx.com. A little while ago, some of you received a book called Hide This in Your Heart by Michael Frost and Graham Joseph Hill. And we said we were going to start using it as we went through the year. Well, the time has come. So we want you to get that book out, dust it off, and open it up to the introduction. Those who have began to flick through the pages might have noticed that there is a theme that we've become familiar with over the last couple of years. Do you know what that theme is? Bells. Blessing, eating, listening, learning, sending. These are rhythms that we've adopted as a church. And we want to equip and encourage you to see and memorize some of the scriptures that are behind the principle of bells. So what we would like you to do, and encourage everybody to get a hold of this, from the youngest to the oldest, is to memorize one Bible verse this week. And also particularly the adults to read the introduction of the book, because this will help you understand where the book is heading. And at the back of the book, you will find perforated cardboard memory verses in four versions, NIV, ESV, NLT, and The Message. So choose the version that you like. Mine is the NIV. So take the card, 1 Thessalonians 5:11, out of the book and start to work with that. Just to help you, I write mine down on a piece of card. We'll all have different ways of doing this. Remember the technique we showed you a little while ago, writing down the first letter of every word? You know, I find it an extremely helpful way of remembering, and it starts to gel very, very quickly. We also want to be doers of the word, so we want to encourage you to act upon the word that you are memorizing. You know, it seems a lot, but it's not really. And it will help you to cement the word of the Lord in your heart. So that is your bells challenge for this week. And it is this: therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as in fact you have been doing. So it's great. Make it fun. Practice with one another. Test one another. Use it in conversation. Give me a ring and test me to see if I've managed to memorize it as well. Keep in touch and send us your stories. Let's pray to close. And we're going to pray our church prayer as we normally do. Father, make us a church without walls, where Jesus Christ is the core of everything that we do. Teach us to love people better and help us to make disciples. Holy Spirit, equip us for reviving faith in our own communities. Keep us growing and maturing in you. Amen. And now we're going to say the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. We look forward to seeing you next week. Bless you all. Bye-bye.